every time we gather for the sacrament of confirmation, we say together the baptismal covenant, reminding ourselves that we are grafted into this risen body of Christ as living members of the body, called for a purpose beyond ourselves, and that is to proclaim and embody the good news of God's love for all people. I very much like how our new presiding bishop puts it. He talks about us being part of the Jesus movement, and that the early church understood itself to be part of a movement more than an institution. And that as that movement, we are called to make disciples of Jesus who will change this world by the power of God's love. That love is what changes lives and changes this world. And that, as he says, if it's not about love, it's not about God. It's always about love. So, Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they will follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." In this morning's gospel, Jesus once again refers to himself as the good shepherd of the sheep, the good shepherd. When we hear reference to the good shepherd, I imagine that we make a link to the most famous of Psalms, the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And images of still waters and green pastures, along with a sense of refreshment and comfort and mercy and goodness, they're given voice as we ponder the Lord as shepherd. We can imagine that as Jesus speaks of himself as the good shepherd, his audience makes the same link. And when Jesus calls himself the good shepherd, surely some in the audience will protest such a reference as blasphemy, as we heard in this passage. And others, on the other hand, will begin to welcome Jesus as the shepherd, as their Lord, and even follow him. And they will follow the one who makes such claims as, "I am the good shepherd." And they will discover that what Jesus says is true, that the good shepherd is willing to lay down his life for his sheep. Unlike the hired hand for whom tending sheep is strictly a job, the good shepherd is invested in the well-being of the sheep. The sheep belong to the shepherd. The good shepherd cares for the sheep and will even give his life to save his sheep. So the sheep trust the good shepherd. They will run from the voice of strangers, but the voice of their shepherd they will follow. The sheep follow him because they know his voice. Now, probably no one can live in our culture today without hearing plenty of conflicting voices. Some of those voices are easily discerned as tempting us down a wrong path. And perhaps the most blatantly wrong voices are not even that tempting. It's the subtle voice that has the power, the well-disguised voice, the culturally accepted voice, even sometimes the religiously accepted voice, which has the subtle power. I suspect the most subtle and yet powerful voices we hear tell us how we ought to live and who we ought to be somebody in this world. The easy target here, of course, is television, and I say that as one who lives in a home with more televisions than residents. I would say social media is another such voice. We would like to think that we are so well-balanced that we are immune to the constant barrage of messages, but even the constant drip of water eventually erodes concrete. And before long, we ought to have this perfectly sculpted body. We ought to have a perfectly functioning body. We ought to have all kind of new stuff. We ought to enjoy the company of lots of friends on big trips to exotic places. And I want to emphasize these are all good things. These are all good things, of course. Even television and social media are good things. But the constant voice tells us what we ought to do or have or how we ought to act. Or somehow we are left out. We are happy. We are not happy. We are not in the loop. We're not with the cool kids on the playground. We don't really belong. Now, television commercials and social media are the easy targets and perhaps the not so subtle targets as voices shaping our perceptions, especially for our young people. But these voices come from all sides, including the cultural and the religious, sending the fundamental message that we are not enough if we don't have and do all the right things which measure success. Some of it even has the theological overlay that if everything falls into place, it is evidence of right living. It's that theology of Job's friends in the book of Job, who insisted that Job's world was falling apart because he must have sinned somehow. It's that theology which claims that failure is a sign of sin. And failure is a consequence. The consequence of failure is falling out of favor with God. That success is a sign of clean living and God's favor, according to the theology of Job's friends and some of today's preachers. I would suggest that is the predominant voice of our culture. You will be somebody who counts if you are successful. You count if you succeed. You count if you are important. You count if you are attractive. If you are attractive. If. You count if. The voice comes from all sides, not just television, but in and through all sorts of cultural and religious voices. But the voice of the shepherd is a different voice. If we recall the voice from heaven at the baptism of our Lord, the voice proclaims, "You are my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." That voice says what is true all along. Says what is true all along about Jesus. A proclamation made before Jesus accomplishes one thing in his public ministry. It's a proclamation to be heard at every baptism. True all along for everyone baptized. You are my beloved child. With you I am well pleased. Before you accomplish one thing in life, you are someone who counts already. Everyone is a child of God, of no less value to God than Jesus himself. Not if you succeed, not if you are perfect, not if anything. The Good Shepherd will seek you when you are lost. The Good Shepherd will revive your soul. The Good Shepherd will walk with you through the valley. The Good Shepherd even gives his life to save you, because you are somebody already. You are his. Every time someone is baptized, a gathered congregation is asked a question. The question will be asked for this confirmation liturgy as well. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ? In a way, we are being asked this: will this baptismal candidate hear from us the voice of the Good Shepherd? Will we communicate to her or him their fundamental value? Will we teach them and show them with our lives that they can trust the Shepherd? Will we show them with our lives which voice to follow? That's the question for us. At each celebration of baptism, will we mentor them? Will we show them how to be disciples, whom to follow, and how to follow? theologian named Dallas Willard compares being a disciple with being an apprentice. A disciple is like an apprentice, he says. The apprentice of a musician or a politician or a lawyer or an artist, for example, is a disciple, a follower. But he says, if asked whether they are good apprentices of whatever person or line of work is concerned, the apprentice very well might hesitate. They might say no or yes. But asked if they could be better students, they would probably say, yes, I could be better. I mean, who wouldn't? For to be a disciple in any area or any relationship is to be less than perfect, obviously not perfect. One can be a very incompetent beginner and still be a disciple, he says. So if you're an entrepreneur, or a homemaker, or a professor, or a doctor, it's likely you have a mentor, a voice whom you follow, at least sometimes, someone in your profession, a parent or a friend. You might even refer to yourself as a disciple of some other leader or teacher or coach. I know that I have mentors, a number of carefully selected mentors. Now, obviously, from a mentor, I want to learn something. I want to learn how to do something, how to become who I'm called to be. Part of a mentor's job is to teach and to challenge. I want that in a mentor. But there is something else just as important, and maybe more so. In front of my mentors, I hope that I'm allowed to be weak. I hope I don't have to be perfect. I hope I'm allowed to say, I'm not very good at this or that, or say that I am good at something. I hope I'm allowed to say it. I hope I don't have to impress my mentor with my good job or my abilities or my talents. If things are unraveling or falling apart, I hope I don't have to hide it from my mentor. I want someone who is safe. And I bet you do too. If it's not safe to be vulnerable, if it's not safe to fail, it is not the voice of the Good Shepherd. That's another different competing voice. We can trust the Good Shepherd. He walks with us through the valley. He seeks us when we are lost because we are His. We belong to Him. He says, "You are my beloved child." That's the voice of the Good Shepherd, and that's the voice we follow and proclaim in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God, in whom we live and move and have our being.